Morning, everybody. How are we doing this morning? All right. Feeling pretty good. The sun is starting to come out. The last couple days have been kind of gloomy, but the sun is coming out, so that's something to be thankful for. A little warmer weather. I hate the cold, so it was a little chilly these last couple days. But if everyone can just stand, we're going to go into worship. We're going to get to praise the Lord. And I don't know where you are with your walk, in your walk with the Lord this morning, but just know that no matter where you are with him, he's always chasing after you. He's the one that continues to pursue you when you've drifted, even when you've grown close to him. He always continues to pursue you. So Jesus, we love you. We thank you, Father, for the love that continues to chase after us, the love that's unconditional, Jesus. We honor you today with our time. And we thank you and we pray that this would be a sweet incense unto you, Jesus. We love you, we honor you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, church. You know, we're about to sing this song called Reckless Love. And what that reminds me of is a passage of scripture in the Bible. It's a parable where it talks about the prodigal son, right? And here it is, you have this son that strays away, far away from the father. And he has this prodigal type life, this lavish life where he spends all his money on all the wrong things. And when he comes back to the father, I love this use of the word prodigal, because when we think about it, we only think about the negative side of it. We think about this, you know, this awful young kid that was spending all his money on all these horrible things. But the other side of that word, prodigal, there's a beautiful meaning to it. It means to give without expense, right? It means to give lavishly and to give it all. And that's what the father does in the passage. He gives his love freely and prodigally and lavishly to the son when the son returns. So I want us to think about that, because like we get in our relationships, we get into our marriages, and we pursue them to get into that. But it's like once we get into it, we get a little content, but then the father never gets content. He's constantly coming after us. He's constantly giving us his love lavishly. So think about that in the forefront of your mind as we get ready to go into worship, that lavish love that God has for us.
For us smooth shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Sing it out, church. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom, I speak Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is love.
And I just want to speak the name of Jesus. Thank you. Bible says those that wait upon the Lord shall do what? Renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. Teach us, Lord. Everybody say, teach us, Lord. Patience is a virtue. Teach us, Lord, to wait. Amen. Hey, look at somebody. Tell them everything's going to be all right. Tell them everything's going to be all right. Amen. You may be seated. We want to welcome you today. Welcome you watching online. And I'm looking around. I don't see any first-time guests here today. But if you are, we welcome you. And also, you can. They're going to put on the screen. You can text WELCOME FC to 84576. We will get you on our text and email list. And that's where we send out exciting information every week about what's taking place at Family Cathedral Church. So if you're not receiving a text, if you're not receiving an email, and if you're new to the church, please text WELCOME FC 84576 or fill out the little form, the little card right there in the seat back in front of you. Let's get our hands together and welcome everyone here today. Come on, Nicole, come on. Everybody get your hands together. Everybody passed a lot of churches to be here this morning, so we welcome you as well as those watching online. God, oh my gosh, I had Pastor Josh print off everything we got going on, so hope I don't forget anything. Pastor Jeremy, you and Pastor Andrew, help me out if I forget something here. I would need a veteran. If you're a veteran, sign up in the foyer at the close of the service. We have a special gift for you on November the second Sunday of November, whatever that is. So I think it may be the 13th or whatever. But at any rate, we've got a gift for you. Right at the close of service today, Young at Heart is going to Circle Grill. So if you're part of our seniors ministry, you're welcome to go to Circle Grill with us right at the close of the 10:30 a.m. service. Then we've got the toy drive. We do this every year, four Sundays in November. Next Sunday, we're starting with sports gear. We'll have the container there in the foyer, so bring sports gear beginning next Sunday morning. Now listen, you don't have to remember all this. Again, we'll be firing this out through email and text. But since you're here, toy drive next Sunday morning, beginning with sports gear. Pastor Andrew, what are you doing Wednesday night? You got some kind of a cook-off going on. What's going on?
I love the curveball. Anything for the mic, right? Hey, are y'all excited this morning? I hope so, because you should be. Wednesday night, we're doing our chili cook-off. So if you don't want to make chili or know how to make chili, just come eat good chili. How about that? So we're going to do our chili cook-off, just kind of kick it in. It's getting a little colder out there. So if you want to make chili, we are going to give out some gift cards, some giveaways. Sign up in the foyer so I can contact you this week on how we're going to do everything, okay? Love you guys.
That's just Wednesday night. We'll begin eating at 6:15, first Wednesday, and then 7 o'clock we'll have service, Bible study, etc. And then Family Blast today. If you do not know what's going on with Family Blast, you need to check your pulse, pick a lily, and lay over. You are dead. But at any rate, that's today from 4:30 to 7. Give Pastor Josh and the leadership if you got any more questions about that. But that's right here today on our parking lot from 4:30 to 7. All right, I think I covered everything there. Don't believe I forgot anything. So we're going to receive our morning tithe and offering. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. And again, I just want to encourage you, don't just give, but give how? How? Cheerfully. Whatever, great or small, whatever you have to give, give it cheerfully. Because the Lord loves a cheerful giver. Father, we love you this morning. Truly is an opportunity to be in your house to worship you in spirit and in truth. Thank you for those that got up just a little bit early to come out today. Father, we got a great day going today with two services. Young at Heart going to the Circle Grill for time of food and fellowship. Our Family Blast, our annual Family Blast. It's going to be a great day at Family Cathedral Church. We pray blessing over everything that we say, everything that we do. Bless our gift, the giver of the gift this morning as we bring our tithe to the storehouse, our offering, and most of all, Father, help us, whatever we give, help us to give it cheerfully. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen and amen. Bless you as you give. You can give in person. You can give online. You can can text to give 972-441-7476, or you can mail it in. And thank you so much for your financial support. Amen. I know Pastor Jeremy is ready to go. Let's stand our feet and give this man of God a... He's excited about that word he got for us today. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Pastor Harry. Give it up for Pastor Harry and all of our staff during Pastor's Appreciation Month. They do a great job, guys. Y'all don't understand everything that they do for this church and for you. Turn to Philemon for me. Some of you are probably like, where's Philemon? It's in the back of the book. So, one of the biggest books in the Bible. Okay, some of y'all know that was a joke. Okay, good. Some of y'all know the Bible a little bit. That's good. But I want to share with you today about how to be active in sharing your faith. And I'm not going to go right into the scripture yet, but what I want to talk to you a little bit about today is, do you understand everything that we have in Christ? Everything that we have in Christ. And if you don't, today I hope to enlighten that a little bit with you. I want all believers to understand the full understanding that everything you have in Christ. And the way to do that is to be active in sharing our faith. That's how we can have that full understanding. So I want to look in this passage in Philemon, but before I do, let me give you a little backstory to this passage that I'm going to be reading. Paul writes this letter to Philemon, and this is the only recorded letter that they have in the Bible. There might have been others, but Paul writes this letter directly to Philemon on behalf of Onesimus. How many of y'all heard of Onesimus in the Bible? Probably not too many. Maybe Pastor Doug, Pastor Harry, maybe some of those guys. But what happened is Paul writes to this Philemon, who's a businessman who has a small group in his church, or small group in his house, a church service, so to speak. And what happens is Paul says, hey, Philemon, I ran into this dude, Onesimus. And Onesimus wasn't a believer, and Onesimus was a slave of Philemon. And he left Philemon, like just took off and bolted one day, runs into Paul, and Paul's preaching and Paul's speaking, and runs into Onesimus. They hit it off, and he starts asking questions, and Paul's like, oh, dude, you don't know Jesus? Oh, man, you got to know this guy. I used to hate Christians. I used to persecute Christians. But I saw the light. I was changed. And, man, being a believer is like the most awesome thing you'd ever imagine. You need to be a believer. Do you want to know this guy, Jesus? And he says, absolutely, I want to know this guy. I want what you have. And so he converts, or he preaches Jesus, and he accepts Jesus into his life. And then he says, you know what? I've got to go make things right with Philemon. So he goes back, and Paul writes this letter. And look at this passage in Philemon, chapter 1, verse 4 through 6. In verse 4, it says, I always, this is Paul writing to Philemon, Philemon, I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers. And then he says, I thank you for two reasons that he's fixing to give you. Because I hear about your faith in the Lord Jesus. That's reason number one. And then everybody say this with me, and your love for all the saints. And your love for all the saints. I want to think about this. I thank God, Philemon, because I hear that you love other believers. Like you go out of your way for the other believers to fellowship with them and do things for them. I thank God for that. I thank God for your faith in Jesus because you have such a deep love for Jesus that you're having people in your home and you're sharing and loving on other believers. And then in verse 6 he says, but I pray that you may be, and everyone say these next five words with me, active in share. I asked you the first time and, you know, we didn't understand this. So I'm not going to ask. I'm going to tell you. Everybody say these next five words with me. Active in sharing your faith so that you will have a full understanding of everything that we have in Christ. I pray that you be active in sharing your faith. Why? Why do we need to be active in sharing our faith? Well, he says it right there in verse 6. So that why? You will have a full understanding of everything good we have in Christ. Now, what I want you to do is, I like to try to read into stories, right? Like, this isn't like theology or anything like that. This is, as my grandfather would say, this is Sewellology, but this is Jeremyology. And so I always try to, you know, in stories like this, I try to think, okay, what else could have been going on in Paul and Philemon and Onesimus's life? And imagine this, the slave runs away. He gets to Rome where he meets Paul, and maybe he's hurting. Maybe he's going through something. And he runs into Paul. And Paul starts sharing the gospel. He hits it off with this guy. Why was Paul able to hit it off with this guy? Because Paul, too, was once a slave in bondage. He wasn't a believer. He was a slave to that. And he tells him, I used to be like you, man. I used to persecute Christians. And Paul's like, where'd you come from? He says, I'm a slave. I work for Philemon. And he's like, Philemon? Dude, I know that guy. Like, he's an awesome dude. I love me some Philemon. Y'all have friends like that where you're like, dude, I just love, like Drew. I'm like, man, I just love me some Drew. How many of y'all love you some Pastor Drew? I love me some Pastor Drew. I love, especially today, because he's got all that brisket. But he's like, dude, I know him. Oh my gosh, he's amazing. Pastor Drew's so amazing. He has a church in his house. And wait, hold up. You know Pastor Drew, or you know Philemon, but you're not a believer? Like, that would come across to me as like, if somebody knew Pastor Drew, but they weren't a believer, I'd be like, hold up, you've known Pastor Drew how long? You've worked with Pastor Drew? What? You're not a believer? Like, he's never shared Christ with you? He's never shared the goodness of God with you? Like, that doesn't sound right. Let me write him a letter. And so, you see what I'm saying? So then he goes back and he writes the letter to Philemon, and he wants to get across to him. I love it. This is what I want you to understand, guys. I love that you love other believers. And you're sharing your faith with other believers. But I want you to be active in sharing your faith to the non-believers. The problem is, so often we become inward looking and we start thinking and arguing over stupid things. Anybody ever argue over stupid things with other believers? Like, seriously, after you're like, seriously, I'm arguing with you over this? Oh, that's not the way that we do church. Oh, the Greek word actually means, that's not the right version of the Bible. If you do anything other than King James, you know, you're like way off, you know, you're not. We got to get past that. You got to get past that. Why don't we share our faith more often to non-believers? Why don't we? There's many reasons, but one of the things I think that most of us don't share the gospel is because we're maybe scared, a little nervous, right? I mean, again, I'm guilty. Maybe we're nervous. Maybe just time, you know, everybody's busy, right? Everybody leads a busy life. I understand that. But how many times do you come in contact with people where the opportunity presents itself? And I just think Paul's just trying to get something across to us in this. And I think as a church, we do such a great job at that with other believers, fellow Christians. It's easy for me to talk that with Pastor Drew. It's easy for me to talk that with you guys here. But it's not so easy to share it with other people. And so, Cheryl, put that graphic up on the screen for me. So this is what I want you to understand. So we're supposed to share the gospel, right? Jesus didn't say go into the church and preach the gospel to just church people. No, he said go into all the world and make disciples. Be the salt and the light of the earth, right? So this is what I think that happens here. We start off and we share our faith. And hear me, guys, this is it. Like, this is the pattern for how we need to see this. We need to share our faith. Right, you notice in that passage that it says, be active in sharing your faith so that you will have the understanding, right? I think so many times in our lives, we want the understanding first. We're like, I just don't understand it. Pastor, I just don't understand like how I can do that. Well, what Paul's saying is, to get that understanding, you've got to share it first. And so as we share it, lives are impacted. lives are changed. And then after we share it, and then lives are changed, then we start to understand what's taking place. We start to understand and see the difference that God's making in these people's lives. And it kind of changes our thinking a little bit. We understand it. We understand a little more, and it kind of builds a little bit of confidence with it. How many of you ever done something like that where you shared the gospel or you prayed with somebody, and then all of a sudden you're like, who's next? You know what I'm saying? Like, you start to get an understanding, and as you share your faith, you actually get a full understanding of every good thing that you have in Christ. And suddenly you start growing deeper in your relationship with God. And I can't tell you that how many times I say this over and over, the more I practice it, the more I share it, the more understanding and the deeper relationship I have, because I want more. And some of you want more, but you need to step out of the boat. You need to share the gospel, right? So then you have understanding, and then get this. After you have understanding, then you have an outward evangelistic, loving focus towards other people. You start seeing people in a different light. You're not seeing people as, oh man, look at that dude. He's messed up. Ooh. I'm going to like stay away from him. I'm going to go over here, because I don't want to be around that guy. He doesn't look like he's got stuff going on that's good in his life. But you start doing all that stuff, and it's a vicious cycle. And what happens is, as you do that, it just continues to be a circle going around and around. And it starts with sharing at the top. And then it just becomes a lifestyle. And then it's just a daily lifestyle. And you don't even think twice about it. But you got to first share it to get the understanding. So what I want to do with you today is I want to give you four reasons. All that was just like the prequel to everything that I want to share. Did I lay a pretty decent foundation for you there? All right. So the first thing that I want to share with you is on how we can share our faith is you can be loving but direct. There's a time to be loving but direct, right? So in Acts chapter 2, Peter's preaching to hundreds, thousands of people, and he says to them in Acts chapter 2, he says what? He says, you repent from your sins and turn to God and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. That's pretty direct, right? I don't need the Hebrew for that. I don't need the Greek for that. He says, repent and be baptized. That's pretty direct, right? And there's times for that, and I believe there's times that the Holy Spirit will quicken you as a believer to be direct, but you can be loving and direct. See, I think sometimes we're direct because we're like, dude, you're terrible. You're a sinner. You're going to die and go to hell. That's not too loving, right? And Jesus was loving. So we need to be loving but direct. Hey, man, come sit by me at church. Come sit by me. Hey, can I pray with you? Hey, do you know Jesus? There's a big difference. Like, that makes it more appealing to somebody than just like, hey, dude, you need to get your life right, dude. But then there's times you've got to be that way. Be direct with them. Like, I can remember back in the time door-to-door witnessing. How many of you remember that? Can't really do that nowadays because of doorbell cameras. People, you know, first thing they do when the doorbell rings, they're like, oh, I don't know who that is. So it's a little more difficult now, but I do remember back in the day, like, going door-to-door witnessing as a teenager and stuff like that with our youth group. And I always remember a youth pastor would say something, you know, hey, make sure you pray before you go up there. And I'm like, you best believe I'm going to be praying. In the name of Jesus, I pray that they don't open that door and nobody's home. That's what I'm praying. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. That's what I'm talking about. But anyways, it's a different day and age that we live in. So it's easier now to just share Jesus as you go about in your day. The second thing is this, and this is probably one of the most important ones, is you can share your story. Sorry. Devil's been beating me up this week, trying to bring me down to not preach this word. But the second thing is you can share your story. Everybody has a story. Everybody. I don't care if you were brought up in church. You never, like, for example, me, I talk about this. I was brought up in church. I didn't, like, you know, go off and do drugs, alcohol, sleeping around with all these women and all that. I didn't do that kind of stuff. I lived a pretty, like, you know, boring life. I'm vanilla, as Heather says. I'm pretty vanilla. You know, I'm just like, You know, I never had an issue with anything like that, and never, you know, wandered off. You know what I'm saying? You know that word, you know, that, well, you know, we, oh, you wandered off the path. Oh, whatever. Anyways, so that's the first thing we always want to be like, oh, you need to get back on the right path, brother. You left Jesus. Well, how'd you leave Jesus if he says, I will never leave you nor forsake you? Anyways, that's another message. So everybody has a story. One of the greatest testimonies I'm starting to realize is my testimony, my story. Brought up in church, did a lot of things for the church, and now here I am. But there's also amazing stories, like Pastor Drew. He's got an amazing story. It's just as powerful, right? But see, sometimes we tend to think that story is greater than this story. And it's not. A story is a story. Nothing's greater than the other one. The main thing is, I was once lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Everybody has that story. If you're a believer, you were once blind, but now you see. Excuse me, guys, sorry. You used to be a drug addict, but now you're not. You know, some of you guys' stories pretty rough. You know, some of you used to smoke weed, shoot heroin, drink all kinds of stuff. I wasn't like that. I bought the fake cigarettes at the 7-Eleven back in the day that was candy and rolled them up in my sleeve to make me look cool. I bought the fake earring to kind of, you know, the magnet one to make me look cool. You know what I'm saying? Like, that was about as rebellious as I got. So, and drank NyQuil. That was my, hey, let's get drunk. Let's drink some NyQuil. You know, that's about as crazy as it got for me. But tell your version of the story. Tell your story to other people. And it's amazing how many times God leads somebody into your life that they went through the same things you did. I ran into a guy a couple weeks ago at the oil change place, and we just started talking. And on the way out, I posted a picture on social media. But on the way out, I'm about to throw up on y'all. And I'm not talking about spiritual words. I'm talking about like... No, I'm just kidding. And so on the way out, this guy's like, hey, man, what do you do for a living? What do you do? Are you in construction? Because I had a Trutex hat on, and I said, no, I'm not in construction. That's the last thing. Brother, I don't do that kind of stuff. I'm not a handyman. But I said, I'm a pastor. And he goes, oh, really? And he goes, I'm a PK. And I said, well, I'm a GPK. That's a grandparents kid, preacher kid. And he goes, oh, man. And so he just started sharing his faith with me. And that was encouraging to me. And he was talking about some things that his wife has gone through and going through. And so we prayed and so forth. But it's amazing how God leads somebody in your life that you have relationship with, that y'all can relate to people. The third thing you can do is this. The third thing, and this is simple, you can invite people to church. You can invite people to church. It doesn't get any easier than that. Hey, just come. Hey, why don't you come to church with me? It's a little awkward for me sometimes, like, to invite people to church. Like, hey, come to church with and hear me preach. You know what I'm saying? It's kind of awkward, right? I mean, my wife says I preach good, so... I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's kind of awkward for me. One of these days, I'm going to invite somebody and not tell them what I do. I'm going to be able to not tell them. And they're going to come to church, and I'm going to have, hey, come to church with me. You know, hey, I sit in the middle right section on the front row. I'll save a seat for you. Ben, you can go ahead and come up. And so, come sit with me. And I promise you, I'm going to do this one day. And they're going to come sit with me and, you know, be worshiping, praising God. And then I'm going to be like, hey, I'll be right back. And then I'm going to walk up on the stage and I'm going to start preaching. And they're going to be like, what? You invited me to church and you're a preacher and you didn't tell me that? But one of these days I'm going to do that. And I'm going to be able, but it's hard for me to not tell people, like, hey, I'm a believer. Yes, I'm a pastor of a church. Because that's usually one of the first things that comes out is, what do you do for a living? You know, I'm a believer. That's what I'm going to tell them next time. What do you do for a living? Oh, I'm a Christian. That's what I do for a living. The fourth thing is this. You can live a life that other people will want. You can live a life that other people will want. And I think about the story of Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas, you remember, they were thrown into prison. Thrown into prison. And then all of a sudden, what do? They just like, hey... I know we're like shackled up. You know, we're sitting like this and, hey, yo, let's start singing. Let's start worshiping. Worshiping? Bro, we're like shackled and bound. What are you thinking? I can't hold my legs up that long. So they start worshiping. In a moment of probably one of the lowest moments of their life. They start worshiping God. And then what happens? We all know the story. The jail doors start blowing open. The guard's like, oh, dude, this is messed up. All these people, they're going to escape. I'm going to be killed, so I might as well kill myself. And Paul and Silas are like, whoa, 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 jailer, hey, don't do nothing. We're still here. We're not going nowhere. We're still going to worship God during this. We're staying right here. We're right here with you. Don't kill yourself. And then what that does is that makes, I'm sure that jailer was like, what do you mean? Like, the doors are open. Your shackles are gone. You can leave. Yeah, I'm going to be killed, but you could leave. Let me kill myself because that's what they're going to do. No, man, we're going to stay right here with you. Well, that's just crazy, dude. I want what you got. Like, why wouldn't you want to leave? I want what you got. And I think so many times in our life, maybe we don't live that life that other people want. Like, are we living the lifestyle that we say we have so that other people want it? And I pray that that's the kind of example that I set whenever I'm out. That if somebody were to come up to a friend of mine and they know, oh, you know Jeremy? Yeah. He's a pastor? What? He's a believer? What? No. He's not a preacher. No, he's not a believer. Are you serious? That's not what I thought. You know what I'm saying? What do people think? Do you have a life that other people want in that sense of being a believer? You can live a life other people want, and that's so important. So important. Let me give you three things real quick, and I'm running short on time. Three things that will happen when we share our faith. One, you get to play a part in a divine story. In a divine story. You get to play a part in someone else's spiritual story. How cool is that? How cool is that? It may be you're watering the seed. It may be you planted the seed. It may be that you're reaping the harvest. But you're playing a part in that. Number two, your faith grows. Your faith grows. You have conversation with someone and you don't know what to say. And the next thing you know, you're like, boom, a Bible verse just pops up in you. I can't tell you how many times when I'm speaking to somebody or talking to somebody, something pops in my head that I'm like, where'd that come from? Even when I'm preaching, stuff pops in my head and I'm like, that wasn't even in my notes. Thank you, Holy Spirit. The third thing is this, you are reminded of what you have in Christ. You're reminded of what you have in Christ, and that's why you have full understanding in Christ. Some of you here that were there at one time in your life, right? When you were really passionate about Jesus. How many have ever been there before? I know I have, but I can guarantee you from the time that if you say now I'm not that passionate anymore, I can tell you one of the reasons why, and probably the most important reason why, is you're not sharing your faith. You're not sharing your faith like you should. You're not sharing your faith. So today, I just want to leave you with this, and everybody stand with me real quick. If you're here today and you say, you know what? I want to live that lifestyle. I don't want to just speak it. I want to live it. Actions speak louder than words. Let's lift your hands up for me real quick. Amen. I mean, everybody's hands, unless you're there already. That's great. Awesome for you. So awesome, guys. Like, we get to share and live with Christ in us. When we walk out these doors, it's not just you walking out. You're walking out as a representative of Christ's kingdom. Jesus inside you, and you have the power to do anything because Jesus inside you. We can't do it with our flesh. We can do it through our spirit. So I just want to pray over you real quick that you'll be active. Guys, we've got to be active in sharing our faith. There's a lot of empty seats out here, and there's a lot of hurt and dying people out there. Today at the Family Blast from 4:30 to 7, if you're not going to be here, you need to be here because it's going to be crazy madness here. It's going to be awesome, guys. Like, just come and be a spectator and like be like, it's going to be awesome. But there's going to be opportunities that are going to come your way because of the Family Blast. As we get information and as we meet people, we can share Jesus. not by even just saying, hey, do you know Jesus as your Savior? But just being Jesus out there and representing Him. Amen? That opportunity is there, and I pray that we do that 24/7. Father, I thank you for this day, and God, I speak this over everybody's life today, Father, that they're active in sharing their faith. They don't just share their faith once in a while, not once a month, not once a week, but they're constantly active in sharing their faith, because as we're active sharing our faith, we become more bold and we become more like go get them attitude, Father, to reach the lost and to reach people that are out there that are hurting. The only way we do it is through practicing and sharing our faith. The only way we get better in life at a certain skill is we do it over and over and over again. And God, I pray that you're instilling that into these people's lives, Father, to be active in sharing their faith. God, I thank you for this church and thank you for this leadership. Bless these people in everything that they do. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. The worship team's gonna sing, and we have our building fund down here. And again, today the building fund is gonna go towards Pastors Harry and Debbie and the appreciation that we have for them for what they've done for this church for so many years and continue to do. We're gonna be honoring them in the second service just for a little bit. Take a little bit of time. How many of you know we can take a little bit of time for Pastor Harry and Debbie and honor them in a service, take a little bit of time. So that's what the building fund is going towards today. If you have it, you can bring it down. But before you just take off, at least come down and worship. Worship in your seat before you take off. It's just 9:53, right? Cowboys don't kick off till noon, 9:30, something like that. Amen? God bless you as you give.
Your strength becomes our own, and you make